any other considerations that can go into a bid besides just pure financials? Other requirements that we have in the bid process?
Oh, sure, yes, sir.
Absolutely.
And that could, it could have been taken into consideration.
And it was, I think it was. I mean, that, we had discussions, I mean, that, the thing that, from the accountant that I would question is noted back, that it looks like every, you know, all the I's and T's were dotted on that original bid that, was the 10, what my brother just said, but that first change order of the add-ons, I mean, and what I said, none of that was scrutinized with the same scrutiny as the original bid. So you would think everybody put those numbers down, but I can't answer that. I mean,
well, I still want to go back to where, if we go back to McKinney Park, and I know you're aware of this, and the audit is not in, a bid was issued for $29,998 when they was given a bid number by a company that was over in the 30s that was told them this has got to be a sealed bid. And they bid this thing and it was not sealed bid. If you get under $30,000, it didn't have to be sealed bid. That was $2 under $30,000. Who is making these calls? Is that the administrator? Is that the parks director? Somebody's got to, you know, somewhere we got to know who made these calls, because I asked the administrator about this because the people came to me and said, there's something not right here, it's not fair. We didn't have an opportunity to bid. Mm-hmm. And when I asked the administrator, he came back to me about 3 weeks later and told me, no, everything's fair. You just, you know, you don't get involved in this, you'll get your name in the paper. You know these people, everything's fair, everything was above board.
Like that's
but then when we went back and asked questions about it a year later, we was told from the procurement people, we've never been asked about this. Who ultimately are we looking at that's making these decisions?
Well, obviously.
Because it can't all be one person. Somebody's out there choosing who they want to do these jobs. Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm not sure if we have specifically looked at that particular one. I know there is one that we enumerate in here that was a sealed bid. But let me say this. Obviously, you had the ordinance with the park commission. The director there was coming in and was, I guess from talking to the people, the procurement people are there. There's certain, I mean, the way your system works, you've got procurement, purchase order system. You get a purchase order, that's the approvals. There's certain, that's where you do the 25 to 50, you do all that. Then that goes to finance, they write the checks. You'll see later on in here that, you know, that can be a cumbersome thing. People in all organizations, I gotta get the, you know, that's just trouble. So there's always pressure there, you know, well, we can't do it, you know, whatever. But right there, you know, most of the purchases should go through there and should go through the purchasing system there. But if not, there are two other things. You can get a voucher, or you can have things that call a purchasing card. And I have issues with that here. And what I think is what was happening, that because of this ordinance over here, that the Parks Commission, those in the leadership role there, I think there were questions. You should do this, you should do that. I've been told that, but no, I'm independent. You got to do it this way.
Correct me if I'm wrong. The voucher's up to
$1,000.
Is that what it is?
We saw a bunch of things come through over $1,000 too.
Yeah, I mean,
I don't know if it specifically is limited to
$1,000.
I think they're supposed to be using emergency type.
Well, we'll get to that. I mean, but I mean, a voucher is supposed to be only used when it's, let's say, an emergency. I mean, let's say you've got something broken, you've got to get it. I mean, and you go and do it. And it takes approval of the part of the supervisor. It should be small amounts of money, nothing large. The voucher system over in parks, it was being used a whole lot more than it should have been.
When they had an emergency at the same supplier in February, four times one day, all of it went to the same park. Obviously, all of it was the same job. They're circumventing.
I would say
when it goes over $1,000, they had to get two bids. one of these four with this, from anywhere from 2 or 3 cents to maybe a dollar under that. Who's making those decisions? That's the people I want to know, who they are and why they made those decisions and why they done that.
Well, I think if all you'd have to do is look at the voucher and who took the voucher in. I mean, there are certain employees that did that.
Whoever signed the documentation?
And the names are down there. You know, the director of the commission, some of the purchasing people within Parks and Recs did. You know, and theoretically, that when you use the voucher, you're supposed to have documentation and there's certain approval there. And we addressed that. It's addressed a little bit later, but some of that is ongoing and looking. But I mean, you can, when you get over there, you'll see that the director of Parks and Rec and I don't know how many other people, that they weren't following this procurement policy. So they used a lot of vouchers. They used one of them used personal credit cards to get stuff. That's written up in here too. But
that'd be $13,000. Personal credit card.
Something in our neighborhood over the 4 years that were put in for reimbursement. That's an issue in here too that we'll get to. But you can confuse all of those things. I mean, everything should be going through purchasing and a purchase order. That's the way it should be. If for some reason the timing won't work, you can get a voucher. Now, for other little things, you've got e-cards or purchase cards that people can go out and get, but those are normal things and low-cost things, and there is documentation when it's put in. So, you know, the idea is that the supervisor over the person can approve that looked reasonable. I mean, there's 1,300 employees, and you've got a bunch of different things out there. It's decentralized, and, you know, so you've got these controls over it. So those type of things work when the controls are correct. The $1,000 issue in that, I don't think that's necessarily a voucher issue. It could have been done on the purchase order. But yeah, there are issues there of it looks, you know, it looks strange that you got an invoice on one date, they're all five of them dated, and the amounts are $999, $999. And I mean, and those lists are included in here. I mean, if you go back, at least the list will provide it to the county to look into these issues. And they're all in this first chart. If you go back to these pages, you'll see exactly what you're talking about. I've just got the findings over here. We'll get to those.
Stan, when I wrote it, Stan, I do want to get back to what we're talking about we were back on page 8. I want to talk about this tree change order and go back to the original contract. Anybody look at that add-on list to see if that was the add-ons or anything comparable to anybody else's base bid and how that related? Did anybody do any kind of analysis? The reason I'm asking, the two instances that Councilman Mintz brought up, that $29,998 contract that was awarded a couple months later had a change order for roughly $4,000, which put them right in line with the other bid that wasn't taken. The park that we talked about in Bowling Springs that had a contract, and then a couple months later we had a change order for grading the outfield. And you know, we should obviously, you know, unless you're playing in the hill somewhere, you're not going to be playing baseball on a field that's not graded. So it seems that there's a pattern of using change orders to manipulate a contract to make the original bid to look better, take the contract.
That's very possible.
Then sign a contract for something, in this case, which was over budget already, and put us in the hole right off the bat. But the original bid was taken because it was at least in line. So Sossaman's probably, like you said, not doing anything, but there's some concern on our part that these change orders are being used to circumvent, you know, correct bid and contract procedures. And is that, did you look at any of those? Did you take
well,
a look at
that,
the
I mean,
add-ons to see if they were comparable to a base bid?
I didn't mean to imply that we weren't concerned about saying that, because that is definitely
a concern, and that's why, you know, it was pointed out to management, you know, 2 months ago about this. But it gets back into the technical area that we can't judge. But to answer your question, with the add-ons, when we saw that they weren't tabulated, the first change order, everybody, well, we took four bids or three?
I think I took the bottom three.
We took the bottom three, the lowest guy, the one we took, and then the one right above it. And we looked to see, you know, what was provided in their bid package, because that's what my first concern was. Okay, if you got this bid, were these add-ons adequately disclosed,
right,
so people had it? And what we saw, they were. That everybody had the same list of add-ons. Now, I looked, and you can see there were different prices for the add-ons within those three contracts. We did not see where anybody gone through to determine what effect choosing those within one or two would have on the original bid that was taken.
Well, so what you're saying is that everybody had relatively the same add-ons?
Yeah, they priced the same add-ons.
And the base bid was all based on relatively the same?
Well, the base bid was based on everything but add-ons.
Right.
And
right.
Add-ons were listed probably 12 different things.
What I'm asking is that the add-ons that we chose, were they included in anybody else's base bid?
I wouldn't think so, because they were specifically listed. At least the three we looked at, it was all, that part was a level playing field.
So everybody's base bill was based on the same quoting, the same construction.
It should be, because they have to go to Image Technologies or wherever to get the actual specs to bid on.
Okay, so we gave specifics for a bid contract. They bid on that, and then they said, here's the other thing that we can do. So the add-ons were all add-ons that everybody agreed on.
Everybody saw my concern from an accounting standpoint, as we listed, that the add-ons weren't tabulated. I might question why some of these add-ons weren't part of the base bid.
But they weren't.
They weren't. That's what I'm saying. They probably should have been. There could have been part of the base bid rather than over there. You know, because, and all the add-ons weren't chosen, but I mean, and I can't tell you off the top of the head of my list, but some of them looked to be, I don't know why they weren't the base bid.
How can you build a park without these items here?
I understand that.
That's the bottom line.
But everybody's base bid, it was the same, so everybody was on the same playing field. So that was all legit, like you said. Everybody followed the same procedure. So there wasn't any manipulation later on to say, well, he got this. He didn't put in trees, and everybody else put in trees, and that's why he was lower.
No, so everybody got the base bid. Okay. But what I'm telling you is that I don't know, the trees might have been an add-on.
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, if you look at the add-ons, I mean, from management's perspective, I don't know what the add-ons obviously totaled $500,000 there. They might have totaled, you know, a wish list of $600,000-$700,000. Well, if it's that close, I mean, it could stand to reason some of those shouldn't have been add-ons and should have been in the base bid.
But that's a whole other discussion,
right,
as to whether we planned properly.
Exactly. That's exactly.
But that's not a contract issue. That's just, should mm-hmm. we have thought about this beforehand? And
or was that used to manipulate it later on?
Yeah. Internally, not the original.
Right, bid. Exactly. Okay.
And that would be a good exercise to go back and look at, but that's done. I mean, it's over.
One of our recommendations was that the engineer, somebody with an engineering background, look through this.
Because typically what you do, when you bid, you know, and we've been all the time, you'll have a base bid, and then you have alternates, and you'll list them all down. So every contractor's bidding it, they bid a base and then alternates. If you want to upgrade these things, and then you can look at it. You look at a base and you add everybody's alternates. Well, if we take this, and that's kind of how you do it, to be fair to everybody.